Knowing they're being tracked in this stolen ship, our heroes make a pit stop on a nearby planet called Tatooine. And with a little help from the Force, the group is able to trade in the ship they stole for another. Anakin's getting more and more impressed with Obi-Wan's abilities. Our heroes were interested in the local pod racing, but they decided they needed to get on their way. Now in a ship with a bigger hyperdrive, they should be able to get to their destination quicker. Now if they could only agree on what that destination is. Obi-Wan comes in from one of the communication rooms and says, "I was just talking to the Jedi Temple on Coruscant. A group of Naboo citizens escaped from the Trade Federation's prisons with the help of Qui-Gon Jinn and made it to Coruscant, where they stated their case in front of the Senate. After indecision from Chancellor Valorum, a group of senators voted a vote of no confidence. Valorum was voted out, and a man named Chief Palpatine is the new chancellor. From behind them, they can hear Padme's voice say, 'Chief Palpatine's the new chancellor. He's Naboo's senator.' Jar Jar speaks up and says, 'That's great. He'll be sympathetic to the plight of Naboo.' Obi-Wan continues, 'Palpatine's already pushed for a reinstatement of an army. The Jedi are out recruiting volunteers. But if what we suspect about that clone army is true, it won't be enough.' Queen Amidala says, 'And that is why, Master Jedi, we're going back to Naboo.' Obi-Wan says, 'There's no way. If the Trade Federations get those factories open,' Padme cuts Obi-Wan off, 'I will not let my people die alone. If this is the end of the Naboo, then it's the end of me too.' Obi-Wan says, 'With all due respect, Your Highness, this isn't just about you or the Naboo. It's about a clone invasion of the galaxy. And those codes in your head will give the clone armies a never-ending hyperdrive depot.' Jar Jar cuts in this time, 'With all due respect, Master Jedi, this isn't your decision. The Queen and I are going home to fight with our people. If your job is to protect the Queen, you're just gonna have to come with us.' Now Anakin chimes in, 'I'll fight with you too. You three are the only people I have in the universe. And if you're willing to die for your people, then I'm willing to die for mine.' Obi-Wan turns to Jar Jar and says, 'I had this argument till you opened up your mouth. We could have been relaxing safe on Coruscant. Now we've got to go fight a war. Thanks a lot.' Jar Jar replies, 'You are never winning that argument.' Obi-Wan just smiles and turns to Anakin. 'Anakin, do you have a minute to talk alone? There's something you need to know about when I turned the bomb off in your head. I didn't have to reach for the Force. It was already sitting in your head. The Force works differently for everybody. For me, I make contact with it, and it enhances what I want to do, whether that's use my will or my body. But in your situation, I just told it what to do, and it did it for me. Or I suspect you did it for me. I think you were using the force all along to try to disarm that bomb, and all I did was tell you how to do it. Anakin looked shocked. I can't use the force. I can't do the crazy things that you can. Obi-Wan replies, that's because you haven't been trained yet. You've got natural talent, Anakin. And the Jedi can help you hone that talent. Just think about joining when this is all over. At that moment, the ship rocks from an explosion. Obi-Wan and Anakin look at each other and both say, that was a laser blast. They get to a cockpit to find a strange looking ship firing at them. They open communications to hear Jango Fett's voice. You're left without saying goodbye, Jedi. The Kaminoans didn't even get to tell you about their payment plan. Why don't we head back there before I blow up your ship? Obi-Wan replies, those are both tempting options, Jango. Give me just a moment to discuss it with my partners. After Obi-Wan turns off the comlink, Anakin says this ship has shields, but it doesn't have any blasters. Thinking quickly, Obi-Wan tells Anakin to go gather up all the cargo on the ship and go put it by the back door and then seal off that room. Obi-Wan thought to himself, this plan is gonna need split-second timing. May the Force be with me. Obi-Wan rounds an asteroid, so he's out of Jango's vision for a moment, and then he releases his cargo. Jango's laser blasts hit the cargo, and the cargo explodes, making Obi-Wan wonder what was in that cargo. And then Obi-Wan cuts his engines and latches onto the nearest asteroid. Our heroes wait breathlessly for the few moments it takes for Jango Fett's ship to pass them by. Obi-Wan sighs in relief, and then just says, well, let's set course for Naboo. And they jump into hyperspace. Jango Fett's son Boba looks out the window and says, I don't get it, Dad. Why didn't you blast them into space dust? Patiently, Jango explains to his son, during that battle, I got information that the Queen of Naboo was on that ship. She's worth a lot of money alive, and it's easier to track your prey to where they're going and ambush them there than to disable a ship and board it without knowing who or what is on that ship. They could have picked up a whole bunch of Jedi on Tatooine.